Have you ever drank some flat beer? It's just missing some bubbles, but without them it seems pretty dull, not as tasty, and kinda lifeless. For some reason, beer just isn't that tasty without those delicious bubbles dancing across your tongue, and it elevates the flavors present in the beer. Hey, this is Ryan with Beer by the Numbers, and today we're putting our science hats on to dive into the bubbly world of carbonation. Carbonation is a deceptively simple concept. Almost anyone will tell you that to get a carbonated drink, all you have to do is dissolve some carbon dioxide gas into water. Sounds easy, right? Well, if it's so easy, why in the world don't we find carbonated water all over the place in nature? After all, there's a pretty significant amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Or why were beer and champagne the only carbonated beverages available to humans if they wanted something bubbly for hundreds or thousands of years? The answer to that is the science behind carbonation is deceptively complex. You can't just bubble some CO2 gas through some water and expect it to stick around in there. It's just gonna float away as if you bubbled any other gas through water. No, we need something more. We need something strong to force water and CO2 together into a harmonious bond that tickles the tongue. We need pressure. Under standard atmospheric conditions, CO2 is happy to bubble straight to the top of a container of water and float away to the less crowded airspace above that water. But if you make that airspace more crowded by adding more gas, or confine the water to a tight enough space where there is almost no airspace, CO2 is forced to make nice with the water, dissolving into the liquid and leaving behind its bubble form to evenly spread its molecules throughout the water. Some of the molecules even get so friendly that they combine with water to form a brand new compound, carbonic acid. Carbonic acid is, well, it's a pretty weak acid as far as acids go. In nature, it's only strong enough to dissolve limestone, which isn't really saying much, as I've seen limestone erode before my eyes after someone gave it a mean look. Carbonic acid is, however, a very important compound within the human body itself. Most of the cells in our body operate under a pretty simple energy exchange system. Blood delivers glucose and oxygen from the stomach and lungs, and the cells turn that into energy and carbon dioxide that they can use. But now the cells have a problem, because they have all of that leftover CO2, and if it hangs around, it can interfere with what they want to do with all that energy they just bothered to make. So how do they get rid of it? Well, they begin by dissolving it back into the blood to be taken back to the lungs. Now, the science behind this is pretty complicated, but long story short, the cells dissolve their waste CO2 into the blood as carbonic acid using some bicarbonates provided by blood cells, and it sends it back to the lungs where the process is undone and CO2 can be expelled every time you breathe out. So you owe your ability to breathe and be a multicellular life form in the first place to the same process that makes your beer foamy, which I think is pretty cool. Yeah, Ryan, organic chemistry is neat and all, but how does all this science talk relate to my beer? How does CO2 get into beer anyway, and is there such a thing as too much CO2? Well, like most cells in our body, yeast take the delicious glucose that brewers leave in the wort for them and turn it into ethanol and, you guessed it, carbon dioxide gas. And because brewers don't want all sorts of other less than friendly microbes getting into that beer, they seal the fermentation vessels. As we learned earlier, when a water-based solution is sealed in a container with an ever-increasing amount of gas, that CO2 isn't going to be able to leave the wort and will dissolve throughout it instead. That pressure is why old beer barrels and casks were made out of some pretty strong woods like oak and metal rings. They needed to handle all that CO2 dissolving in the water and the pressure it generated. In modern beer production, most of the CO2 is let out of the primary fermentation chambers using airlocks. Brewers prefer to add the CO2 later, usually by shoving a whole bunch of compressed CO2 during packaging into kegs, bottles, or cans. For smaller scale home brewers who don't have the room or the money for a bunch of drafting equipment and compressed carbon dioxide, CO2 can be produced in the bottle after the beer is sealed inside. This process is known as bottle conditioning and involves adding a small amount of extra sugar after the beer has been fermented so that any remaining yeast can produce one last blast of CO2 after they've been sealed inside the bottle. After a couple weeks, that beer will be carbonated just as if you had forced the carbon dioxide in as you bottled it like a professional. So there is definitely such a thing as too much carbonation in beer. Of course, too much of anything can really become bad. First of all, putting in a lot more pressure than your container can handle, and you're going to be looking at a bunch of spilled beer. This is especially important for those who are bottle conditioning, as putting too much sugar in, or doing something as simple as not leaving enough airspace in the bottle, can lead to disastrous results. And even if you don't burst the container the beer is in, all that CO2 is going to try to come out as soon as you open that beer or container. So if you have too much CO2 dissolved in the beer, you're going to end up with an explosion of beer foam and a waste of much of the beer you worked so hard to create. Speaking of foam, if you want to deep dive into that topic, we've already covered it in another video. Click that annotation on screen or check out the link in the description below. The amount of CO2 dissolved in beer is generally measured in volumes. For example, if you have a 12-ounce bottle of beer with 2 volumes of CO2 dissolved in it, you'll have 24 ounces of CO2 in that bottle of beer. Now, it's important to note that CO2 is much, much less dense than water. So if we measured by weight, the CO2 would only be a really tiny portion of that beer bottle's total mass. While beer averages around 2.5 volumes of CO2, there's quite a bit of variation based on style. Beers that are traditionally low in carbonation might be under 2 volumes, but they're going to taste pretty flat. Carbonation at 3 volumes of CO2 is pretty high, but exceptionally spritzy beers can reach up to 5 volumes of CO2. Here are some values for the carbonation level of different styles of beer in volumes of CO2. Cask ales, barley wines, porters, and stouts all have between 1.5 to 2 volumes of CO2. Bottled ales tend to be around 2.3 to 2.6 volumes. European lagers and North American beers are a little bit higher at around 2.5, almost pushing 3 in some cases. And wheat beers are by far the most, having about 3 to 5 volumes of CO2 contained within them. So there you go, a quick primer on carbonation in beer. Not only does dissolved carbon dioxide make beer taste better and more alive, but it also speaks to the complex chemistry that is the world's greatest beverage. If you're feeling bubbly after this video, please, please, please hit that like button down below and consider subscribing if you haven't done so already. Once again, this has been Ryan with Beer by the Numbers, and I'll see you next week with another great beer video.